Okay. Welcome to everybody. Happy New Year. I decided to satisfy the many requests from non-Italian friends by holding this webinar in English. Obviously, in my very bad English, a disaster. So sorry in advance for this. I would help me by reading some notes. So I hope this help and everything will be clear. This webinar follow that my previous on STI, another acoustic parameter. We will deal with the temporal and the spatial acoustic parameters defined by the ISO 3382 standard. Here we take for granted the knowledge of the ISO standard, which for reason of time will be treated and deepened in a specific webinar. I thank Professor Angelo Farina for the partial use of his material and informations. Acoustical parameters are characteristics of the specific room. As we have seen in previous webinar, impulse response is the signature of the room. It is the solid foundation of all the measures in sound system design. Impulse response is the measure closest to the way we, in first instance, listen the sound phenomenon. Pressure changes over time. We are very sensitive to time, and in the room impulse response, we observe all the components of the sound phenomenon with a single shot, with a single glance.
Soundcheck is the definitive audio test disc. It contains practical material. Soundcheck is the definitive audio test disc. It contains practical material compiled as a result of careful research and investigation. Soundcheck is the definitive audio test disc. It contains practical material.
Room impulse response in its logarithmic form is important because from it we obtain the acoustical parameters. Acoustical parameters adds objective data that we can compare with standards. For example, we can introduce in modeling software to calibrate our design. We can exchange with other people in the world. Here, a table with the most used parameters. We have two groups, the energy parameters and the spatial parameters. Energy parameters are decay times like the RT60, T20, T30, early decay time, related to the decay of the room, so to the reverberation. Clarity, C50 and C80. Definition, center time, strength, STI. Spatial parameters are lateral fraction and inter-aural cross-correlation, IACC. Related to the concept of spatiality of sound. The first two parameters are two times for two types of decays of the room, the RT60 and the early decay time. These are parameters that you already know well and to which I will dedicate a specific webinar, so just some general information here. RT60 is related to the concept of persistence of sound in a space stimulated by a sound source. It is necessary to clarify immediately two fundamental concepts that are often confused: reverberation time and the level of the reverberant field are not the same thing. The first is related to the duration of the decay of the room. The second is a level, a quantity of a sound field, the reverberation field. A well-designed sound system is capable of producing a low level of reverberant field, even an environment with high reverberation time. Not all spaces generate a real reverberant field. These environments are called Sabinian spaces, and the field that is generated in them is diffused, homogeneous, stochastic, random. It envelops you in the same way everywhere, without you having knowledge of specific directions of reflections. You can only recognize localized echoes at maximum. Changes in the reverberation time require variations in the absorbent unit or variation in the surfaces of the room or in the geometry of the room. Instead, changes in reverberant field level require changes in the way sound energy is introduced into the room. The field of acoustics and the sound behavior in a room was first formalized at the end of the 19th century by Sabin. Introduced the concept of reverberation time and its first parameter, T60 or RT60, which is the time it takes for sound energy to decay a million times, minus 60 dB, from the interruption of a steady state noise in a confined environment, leaving at last 10 dB over the level of the noise floor. In practice, it quantifies the duration of the sound tail as we perceive it by ear as a sound decay, for example, when we clap our hands in a room. It is measured in seconds. And this concept is still in use, and it is one of the main measures used in acoustics today. Sabin's methodology consisted in producing a continuous loud sound. He used, if I remember, the pipe organ of the auditorium of his university, stopping it and measuring the time it took for decay to become inaudible. The discrete steps in figure here, these gradons, 1, 2, 3, represent the individual reflections which act as sound sources that become inactive one by one as the sound completes its path from source to receiver. To measure the RT60, according to the Sabin's definition, we turn off the source, we wait the time for the level to decay by 50 dB and start counting the time it takes for a decay of 60 dB, making sure to stay at last 10 dB above the background noise level. Today, however, this technique has been almost completely abandoned in favor of method based on the measurement of the impulse response. In practice, in today's world, it is impossible to obtain a decay of 60 dB at the same time to be at last 10 dB over the background noise level as required by the Sabin's definition. The standard, in fact, provides the measurement of RT60 as T20. After the interruption of the source, we wait for the time necessary for a decay of 5 dB. From that moment on, we measure the decay time necessary to reach a value of minus 25 dB. Attention here. This is not the reverberation time yet. The reverberation time is obtained by multiplying this time by 3. Okay. RT60 or T20 or T30 or T10, etc., represent the same value always. They are the reverberation time. It is possible, in fact, to extrapolate the reverberation time in the same way also as T30. Reverberation time is frequency dependent. Typically, the result is shown in octaves bands or thirds of octave bands. As I said, it should be clarified that today the method of the interrupted steady state noise is quite no longer used. Today we use the impulse response method using the traditional pulse sources, or best, the exponential sine sweep method, which I explained in my previous webinar. The decay of the room based on the interrupted source is reconstructed today on the Schrader curve obtained with the Schrader backward integration. On this curve, the reverberation time is calculated. This method transforms an impulse measurement in a steady state measurement. So we have here the recording of an impulse response in its linear form. So we see here all the positive and negative Pascal values. These are Pascal values, pressure values. We need the energetic impulse response. So the energetic form of this impulse response, I obtain this with squaring all these values. Okay, on the squared impulse response, I perform the backward integration to compute the Schrader curve. I try to better explain Schrader backward integration without math, obviously. First of all, it should be remembered that what we handle is not sound, but numbers, discrete values over time. When I measure an impulse response with an impulsive source, I have all the discrete arrivals in time, the direct sound, the first reflection, the second reflection, and so on. On the other hand, when I use an interrupted stationary source in the environment, I have an energy level that represents the energetic sum of all incoherent contributions, instant by instant, direct sound plus reflections, plus background noise, continuously. When the source is turned off, the label start to decay over time. I show you best what I want to explain. I share my first screen a moment. Okay. I open a powerful software that is Adobe Audition, okay? Now, I'm in my room. I have a Behringer microphone on table. I record now in simple way, just as an example, an impulse response. So I adjust properties, device. One to capture. I'm using a Roland Quad Capture. So I choose this as a device. Okay. Okay, and now I record a new file, 48 kilohertz mono, etc. Okay. Test. Okay, these are our impulse response. We choose just one of these, this one, for example. Just an example and nothing of precious. Okay, I think it's okay. Now, I can save with this software, this impulse response. But first I want to show you what I said before. This is not sound, these are numbers. If I zoom on it, I see the real nature of this impulse response. Where is? Numbers, okay? Small values over time. I can save this as a text file. I call this impulse response rec example. Okay, I have saved my impulse response. Now I open another powerful software for us, that is Excel. Very, very powerful analyzer. I open this text file, my impulse response. Where is now? I save this. Okay, so course PPT, webinar, acoustical parameters, whole file, this one. I open this. And here, I have now my impulse response. Of that we are talking about. These are all the Pascal values, pressure values. If I chart this in a graph with lines, I have the waveform showed by my analyzer, the same thing. Okay, I can close can close now this. Perfect. What I have instead are not these linear Pascal values, but the squared impulse response. What I must do? I have to square the all these single numbers one by one. Okay, so these are Pascal squared. And so this is equal to this squared. Perfect for all. Now I chart my impulse response, my squared impulse response, my energetic impulse response. And I have this, all positive values, the squared, no? The squared values of the linear values are all positive values. Now I see best the relation, the energetic relation between reflection and the arrivals also between the reflections. Now I can reconstruct the decay of the room like using a dodecahedron, a continuous noise source, using the impulse response. In the impulse response, I have the continuous noise level, the total energy of my dodecahedron, okay? If I sum all the contributions in the impulse response, I have the total energy. I call this total. So this total of the sum of all the squared values represent the total energy in the room. The continuous noise level of my theoretical continuous source, steady state noise, okay? Source is clear this. So the total energy is equal to the sum of all these values, squared values, closed. Okay, now the continuous noise at the steady state noise at a certain time is stopped. Okay, the source is turned off, so start the decay. I subtract first the direct sound, the first reflection, the second reflection by this total value. Okay, how? Simply subtracting these values from the total. So it's equal to this total energy minus all the single values. Okay. You can see that all these values are similar, very similar. This is the continuous level of the steady state source. At a certain time, the direct sound arrives and this level starts to decay from this moment, okay? From these samples, to be exact. I can chart this. And as you can see, the backward integration, the decay of the room performed by the impulse response. But I need now the logarithmic version of the impulse response and of this backward integration. How? I transform in logarithmic form the impulse response and the backward integration values just calculated, okay? So here I have the log and the the log impulse response, and the Schrader curve. The Schrader curve, see. Okay. I name this just Schrader. So logarithmic means equal 10 multiply logarithmic logarithm of this over the reference pressure level 0.00002 squared. Okay, now all for these the samples one by one. This is my impulse response, my energetic impulse response in logarithmic form. The traditional impulse response you look in your analyzer. I calculate the Schrader also, logarithmic version. So I can chart this in the same way. I add a serial. That I call Schrader. The values are this one. Okay. Okay. And now I have my, with great approximation, is just an example. I have now my logarithmic impulse response with the Schrader curve, okay? We are the analyzer. We can return to the presentation. I hope all this is clear. Moment. Okay, early decay time, also called running reverberation. With this parameter, we will consider only the first part of the early energy of the impulse response, the time on the first 10 dB of decay from the direct source level. It therefore includes the first reflections excluded instead by the RT60 parameter, and therefore is best correlated with the tonal contribution that the first reflections themselves make on the listening experience. In the T20, I measure and listen to the long tail of decay of the room after the direct sound. In early decay time, instead, I listen to the reverb, as I can say, while the music is still playing. Okay, the tail of one note is linked to the next one, creating the phenomena of musical assonance and dissonance. In America, this fusion of notes with high early decay times is welcome. In Italy, Europe, and Latin America, the clarity of the single notes is preferred. Therefore, little early decay time, max 1.5, and a little more of T20, generally is preferred. As we can see, the parameters are objective and international, yes, but the judgment on the numerical values obtained varies according to the country, the cultures, the traditions. Their effectiveness is also related to the musical program. Parameters that are good for one song or one genre may not be good for another. This is why many rooms have variable acoustics. The presence of strong early reflections determines a greater slope in the early decay time. In this case, reverberation time is more than early decay time. And if we have installed the sound system, no, and this measure is to estimate the sound system, this result means that the sound system brings advantages in supporting speech and intelligibility. I hope it's clear. If early decay time instead is equal to reverberation time, the room impulse response lacks initial dominant energy. This suggests that the sound system, for example, that we have installed, does not bring advantages in supporting speech and intelligibility. You see that the two slopes are similar and overlap. In architectural acoustics, early decay time can be reduced by adding first reflections through the use of curved surfaces. Curved reflective surfaces, or using more directional loudspeaker correctly aimed. A successful installation is in a reverberant environment must ensure a short early decay time, then reverberation time for, if possible, obviously, all the positions. Clarity parameter. Two are the parameter for clarity according to the standard, C50 and C80. Question for you. 50 milliseconds and 80 milliseconds are the integration times for the computation of these two parameters. You will see the formula shown in the next slide. Who knows from where these two values come from? This is a question for you. I wait your answer in chat, and in the meantime, I take a very short break. Okay. They derive from our way of listening, from psychoacoustics. These two values correspond to the release time of the muscle of the ossicular chain of the middle ear. That is around 50 milliseconds for speech and 8 milliseconds for music. Also, our brain processes speech with the left side and music with the right side. The left side is faster than the right side. Clarity is defined as a value in dB, so 10 log over ratio. It is the ratio between the early and the late energy. So two quantities that we see and estimate immediately in the impulse response. Positive clarity indicates the presence of a strong direct field or less late energy. In Sabinian spaces, highly reverberant and with zero early reflection, the clarity parameter C represents the direct over reverberant ratio, or in other form, the difference between the level of the direct field and the level of the reverberant field. Since the contribution of the early reflection is irrelevant except in specific listening positions. CV80, clarity for music, symphonic music to be exact, so typically for concert hall, is defined by the ratio between the integration of the first 80 milliseconds of the energy of the impulse response, starting from the impulse of the direct sound, and the integration of the late part of the impulse response, from 80 milliseconds to infinite. In reality, when I talk of energy, I'm talking about squared pressure levels, remember? So I'm not measuring the real energy with an intensimeter probe. The optimal clarity value is when the denominator is equal to the numerator. Looking at the previous formula. In this case, early and late energy are balanced. It is wrong to consider late energy to occur deleterious. It depends, because just as a lack of clarity is a defect, also an excess of clarity equally can be a defect. Professor Farina mentioned the Reggio Fiat in Parma as an example, a Fiat so clear that it is feared by many opera singers. This is because in a theater with an excess of clarity, every small error or drop in voice is easily listening. Likewise, every program demands the right environment. An opera concert in a Gothic cathedral with 7 seconds of reverb, for example, would probably not be a good idea, especially if the audience is used to theaters with excellent clarity, for example, with values of 6 or 7, passing instead to a huge reverberant space with -2, for example, of clarity. Same thing for the C50, the speech clarity parameter, where, however, the integration time is 50 milliseconds. As with music, too much clarity can be a problem in speech. In a heavily treated environment, vocal support is lacking, in fact. I have to scream like crazy because so much energy is absorbed by the walls, and therefore I would make a great effort. If the reverberation time mainly describes the room, evaluating the clarity parameter means, in the case of an audio installation, also evaluating the efficiency of the sound system and therefore of our design. If the reverberation time mainly describes the room, evaluating the clarity parameter means, in the case of an audio installation, also evaluating the efficiency of the sound system and therefore of our design. We can use an FFT analyzer, which allow clarity measurement to better orient a poorly pointed loudspeaker looking at the for the best result for clarity. Similar to clarity, C50 is the definition parameter. It is not in decibel, but in percent. Is the ratio between the early part on 50 milliseconds over the total energy of the impulse response. Knowing C50, you can derive from it definition and vice versa. Clarity parameters has this defect of the drastic cut at 50 milliseconds and 80 milliseconds. It is also not a robust parameter. Repeat the measurement in another position where perhaps a strong reflection arrive and the parameter make a jump of 2-3 dB. Listening, we do not feel these jumps between one chair and another. So as parameter are not perfectly correlate with the listening. That is why the center time parameter was conceived. It is expressed in milliseconds in practice, but in the formula we have seconds, as you can see. It is a sort of gravity center of our squared pressure impulse response over time. It is defined as the integral of the running time tau multiply squared pressure divided the integral of the squared total pressure. The result of this ratio is a timed center time, the balance point between early and late energy. This parameter tell me if energy is centered versus the direct sound and therefore contribute to clarity, or how much the sound is late in time, giving a sense of distance, of reverberation, of a sound image not in focus. For music, the optimal value of center time is again 80 milliseconds, a full speech again 50 milliseconds. Advantages of this parameter. We have a single parameter that I can use for both music and speech. It is robust with little change between positions, 1 or 2 milliseconds at maximum of variations. The value is unique. The definition is simple. It is easily measured at any point, and that can be mapped gradually. Another parameter that is an energetic parameter and is related to what we can define improperly as a measure of room boost is the strength. In practice, we have dead rooms and live rooms. The strength is the sound level of a source measured indoor, referred to the power level of the same source in the free field. Historically, this value was obtained by considering the sound level produced by an omnisource, a dodecahedron of given power, at a point in the room by subtracting the level generated by the same source in an open field or an echoic at 10 meters. So strength is a relative level that tells me how strong the level produced by the reverberated field is compared to the direct field produced by the same source, but in the open field at 10 meters. It is a parameter that is not necessarily calculated from the impulse response, but using the dodecahedron and performing direct measurement along the room according to the indication of the ISO standard using a constant pink noise. Then I calculate the values with Excel, for example, and make a map that easily show me which areas sounds good with high strength and which instead are dead, where the sound has a little energy in practice. What are the optimal strength values? For small orchestras or chamber music in low volume environments, we typically have values even higher than 10 dB. In large theaters, however, there are positive values from 3 to 6 dB. In unfortunate places and theaters, such as the Regio Theater in Parma, again, still IM, even less than 3 dB. In these last places, the voice is not very strong. The singer has to try a little harder, and therefore it is easy to go wrong. In the case of concerts with reinforced sound, don't worry about low strength values. And now, so far we have seen energy parameters, which have to do with the sound energy, with its distribution in time and in space, measured using an omnidirectional microphone. Now, let's see the spatial parameters, which also take into account the vectorial characteristics of the sound field, and which require the use of directional microphones in the specific stereo or binaural microphones. The initial approach was to use directive microphones for gathering some information about the spatial properties of the sound field as perceived by the listener. Two apparently different approaches emerged: binaural dummy heads and pressure velocity microphones. Inter-aural cross-correlation, IACC. It is the first spatial parameter we will see now. For IACC, we use the dummy head microphone, that is a binaural microphone, or a real person with two small microphones in the ear canals, capturing the two impulse responses in both ears. It was attempted to quantify the spatiality of a room by means of objective parameters based on two channels impulse responses measured with directive microphones. Inter-aural cross-correlation is based on binaural impulse response measurement. In practice, it is a question of quantifying the degree of similarity between the two signals recorded. The inter-aural cross-correlation value is a number between 0 and 1. A high inter-aural cross-correlation value means that the signals arriving in the two ears are very equal to each other, and therefore we have no spatial perspective, no sound enveloping effect. The reflection patterns of the two impulse responses are very different. This happens if the room, for example, is not symmetrical, or if the listener is closer to a wall in particular, or in a room with different types of walls, or with different acoustic characteristics, etc. the optimal value for IACC is 0.3. For IACC, if IACC is zero, it means that the two ears are listening to completely different things. From one side, Beethoven, for example, in the other side, rock music. Lateral fraction. This is defined from two channels impulse response. The receiver is positioned in front of the source according to an anthropometric Cartesian system defined by the standard. It consists of an omnidirectional pattern and in a figure of eight pattern with the null facing the source. The figure of eight microphone captures the lateral reflection and give them the more weight, the more lateral they are, according to a law which is a cosine, this is not important now. It gives maximum weight to the energy that comes along the y-axis. Also, along the z-axis, we have a top and bottom nulls. It is therefore a relationship between lateral sound, the one measured along the y-axis. The integration starts from 5 milliseconds, so I exclude the direct sound and part of the early reflections. I get a ratio that is always less than one, with a practical maximum value of 0.7. The optimal value, the optimal situation is when we have 0.7. In fact, when IACC is 0.7, lateral fraction is 0.3. Okay, because lateral fraction is equal about 1 minus IACC. Okay, 0.3, that is, if you remember, the best value. It means that in this case, I have the maximum spatiality and laterality of the sound. In this case, I will have a considerable amount of lateral sound. A spatialized sound is pleasant compared to a mono sound. Feeling surrounded by sound helps and stimulates perception and listening in many contexts. Well, after this overview on the acoustical parameters, just some technical information that we will deepen in the next webinars. About recording techniques, you can certainly use ambisonics techniques that I have yet explained in previous webinar and articles. The recorded format gives us a first order B-format flow from which we can derive the microphone pattern we want in practice. From the omnidirectional component W, we obtain information in terms of pressure and therefore the parameters like T30, early decay time, C50, C8, strength, center time. From the X, Y, Z components, the information in terms of velocity and therefore spatiality, and so IACC, lateral fraction. For analysis, many softwares allow the analysis of impulse response and give you the acoustical parameters. Even the common FFT analyzer provides an estimation of the acoustic parameters, but I not recommend their use for this purpose. But anyway, a brief overview of the mass cam. Here you are looking at room EQ wizard. In the filtered impulse response window, you can find all the acoustical parameters. This is a system. You have only reverberation time and STI, speech transmission index here. Smart, that show you in the impulse response mode, clicking after the recording or the recording of the impulse response, clicking in the button all bands, you have parameters like the reverberation time, RT60, early decay time, C50, C8, and STI, speech transmission index. This is Rita by Pepe Ferré, by Gaudio Solutions, that show you an acoustic impulse response window that perform T30 and early decay time parameters. And you have also a specific window for clarity, C50 and C8. This is Arta by Arta Labs, but what I recommend is the use of specific softwares like the module acoustical parameters of Aurora plugins package by Professor Farina. Okay, we have come to the end. In-depth webinars will follow on these topics. I hope my English has been clear and you enjoyed the webinar. I still wish you a happy new year and try to stay safe as possible. Thanks, bye.